Welcome back to level two of our pursuit towards solver excellence. In this level, we're going to add some additional complexity to our previous model. In addition to the inventory and cost constraints that we entered previously, manufacturing has now heard of what's going on, and they've told us that they only have so much time on two of the manufacturing machines required to make the two different lava lamp models. I've copied and updated the previous version of our spreadsheet. In case you've forgotten how to copy a worksheet, all you have to do is hold the control key down and drag the worksheet to the right an inch or so. Thankfully, when you copy the worksheet by doing this, all of the solver model parameters get copied over automatically, so we don't need to start all over with solver. I've taken a moment and added two new columns here in columns G and H, and then added this lookup table down here that shows that for each of the two models, they require 12 minutes or 0.2 hours of molding time. However, there's a drastic difference in the 28-inch model in the finishing room due to the advanced makeup and finishing touches required to produce the 28-inch model. The 14-inch model takes, again, 12 minutes in the finishing room, but the 28-inch lamp requires an entire 30 minutes or half an hour. Adding the additional math to these cells up here allows us to calculate the time in hours for each of these processes for the number of lamps that we need to produce. Now the plant manager has told us that he can only spare 70 hours of molding time and 100 hours of finishing time to the production of these free lamps that these crazy people in marketing are going to try to give away. Now keeping in mind that we originally found in our previous model that we had enough material to produce 180 of the 14-inchers and 150 of the 28-inchers, let's look at what we see in our total time for these two new processes, aka constraints. So we have 70 hours of molding time, and we're only using 66 of those hours, so that's not a big deal. I can just visualize that I'm going to have 4 more hours of slack there. However, I see that for this previously optimized answer here, we're going to go over on our finishing time needed to produce those 150 lamps. So we see that our previous model will not satisfy all of our needed constraints, so we need to update our model and we'll take another crack at it. To add this newly found constraint, I'll add them to the constraints table over here. I'll now open up the solver parameters dialog box again and add those two new constraints. Let's see, add this cell, less than or equal to is already there, 70. Add another one, and our finishing time has to be less than or equal to 100. Let me bring something cool to your attention while I'm at it, as it's important to recognize this behavior when you're working with solver. You'll see that our previous version of the constraints table had all these cell references in them hard-coded in these cells over here on the left. That isn't necessarily a bad thing, as they're descriptive and help me tell the story of what's going on inside the solver model. Here in the constraints in the solver model, see the total cost? It used to be H5, now it's automatically J5. I didn't have to change anything. If we look in our solver model, when I added those two columns into the middle of the table, solver recognized the need to automatically edit the cell references to their new home. See, it automatically updated the objective cell from H5 to J5. It also adjusted all of these others. I'll update all of these cells in column A to our constraints table by hand, which is kind of a pain, but it's important that it accurately describes what's going on in the solver model, so they need to be in sync with each other. Okay, I got that fixed, so I feel a lot better about life. I know you're probably thinking that I need to get a life, but I enjoy this one, so bear with me for a few more minutes in this class. Make sure that we're in simplex mode here. Now let's run our solver again. Boo! Solver could not find a feasible solution. Another telltale sign is when we don't get an answer report up here in the reports box. Let's look at the sheet to where solver gave up on its quest for an optimal solution that satisfied all of our constraints. I see that our molding time is still below 70, but our finishing time is already over 100. Since the model worked before that we added these two constraints, that's another clue that one of these two is my problem and caused an infeasible solution. We just don't have enough finishing time to come up with an answer now. If we get an infeasible solution, there are a few things you can do. One is to reset the changing cells, I3 and I4, back to empty or null, so that the model gets to start over from a fresh start. You'd be surprised how often this fixes things. Sometimes when there are pre-existing values in the changing cells, Solver starts recalculating from that point and spends its time searching from that point as opposed to starting from scratch, and it might time itself out before it gets to the best optimal answer. Another thing we can do is to attempt to get Solver to finish its job is to go into the Solver options to see if something is amiss. There never should be, but if you inherited someone else's work, they might have gone into here and messed something up. We see here that the precision of the constraints will be calculated down to the millionth. That's fine. The ignore integrity constraints box is unchecked. That's good. The max time is set at 100. Generally, in this class at least, if a solver takes longer than 20 or 30 seconds, it probably isn't going to work, and you can hit the escape key on your keyboard to abort that process. I would never give you anything that doesn't solve in 3 or 4 seconds, at least on my machine. If you have a complex model and are getting a less than optimal answer that you know is wrong, you might want to up the iterations from this 100 here. How high should you adjust it? I don't know, try 200, try 1,000, see what works for you. There are some other options up here for nonlinear solutions, but everything in this class will be linear, so you can just use this page and the simplex linear algorithm, as I mentioned in the last video. One cool way of telling you which constraints are keeping us from coming up with an answer is to ask Solver to actually save the model. I'll go into saving the model in more detail in the next video, but here's the Reader's Digest version for now to help you figure this out. If I open up Solver Parameters box again, I see that the Load Save button's over here. Let me click on it, and we get to this point. To load a model from scratch, select a range of cells holding the save model and then click on the load button. We're not going to do that now since we don't have anything saved, but to save a model, here we go, select an empty range of cells, and there isn't a number here. That's curious. We'll see more about that in the next video. That's because the model that you have isn't currently valid, and it doesn't know how many cells it's going to take to store the valid model. But if I go over here and click on L1 and then hit save, it saves what we got. So let's take a look at what we have here. The top cell is actually a link to the objective cell. So I can see here the current value of 300 in this cell. The next number down is the number of changing cells. So that's 2, no big deal. But these cells here containing all these true and false values are actually formulas that tell us about the constraints. For each of these constraints, if it says true, that means that for this constraint, D5 is less than or equal to C11, is D5 less than C11? Yes. So if it's true, that means that that constraint is satisfied. If it's false, that means that that constraint is not satisfied. If I click on this false one here, I see it's the constraint that says that H5 has to be less than or equal to C16. So that's where my solver problem gave up, and it's the root of our problem. It's in conflict with one of these other constraints that are above it. Which one, I don't readily know, but at least I have a starting point from which to investigate. We see that if we have to produce 150 of both of the lamps, we're going to go over on our finishing time. There's just no way around it. This means that someone is going to have to reduce or rethink their stance on their constraints or business rules. We can either talk to the marketing department about their limitation of 150 of each of the two lamps, or discuss with the plant manager the possibility of allocating more finishing time, since these are the two constraints that seem to be in competition with each other. I suppose you might be able to get all the parties into a meeting to iron this out, or maybe a combination of the two options. After getting everyone together and talking through everyone's issues, the marketing department decided that producing fewer than their originally specified 150 of the cheaper 14-inchers would be okay with them since they were really wanting to market and sell the higher-end 28-inch models. So now that we have our problem resolved, how do we handle this in our spreadsheet and the solver model? There are a couple different ways to do this. We could go back into the Solver Parameters dialog box over here and remove the constraint completely of the 14-inch minimum quantity, but I'm not a fan of altering the model since you know it works. A better idea would be to go into C9 and edit this constraint of 150 that we say that we have to have down to zero. That way, we'll get our 150 28-inch models and as many of the 14-inch models as we have time to produce. Going back in and editing our model, we now get a feasible solution and have an answer report. So I'll select it, and then I can go in and take a look at it for a second. Closing this box out, we now see that we have 150 of the 28-inch models and 125 of the 14-inchers. Now, glancing at the answer report to see which constraints are binding now, we see that, as we surmised, there are now two binding constraints, the minimum of 150 of the 28-inch models, and we also completely run out of our finishing room time. There's no slack in either of those constraints. That's it for level 2. I'll look forward to seeing you again in level 3.